William Morrow and Harper Audio present Blood, Sweat, and Chrome, the wild and true story of Mad Max Fury Road by Kyle Buchanan. Read by Fred Berman, Aspen Vincent, Dan Bittner, Derek Perkins, Eva Kaminsky, Fiona Hardingham, Gary Furlong, George Newbern, Ione Butler, Jason Culp, Jeff Gurner, Katherine Littrell, Leon Nixon, Lisa Flanagan, Malk Williams, Michael Crouch, Polly Lee, Ralph Lister, Robin Miles, Samuel Roukin, and Will Watt. A note before we begin. For a complete cast of characters and a list of sources, be sure to download the accompanying enhancement PDF from your audiobook provider. Or go directly to www.harpercollins.com/audio/blood-sweat-and-chrome. Author's note. In the world of Mad Max, a memory can become a legend based simply on who's doing the telling. Stories from the past are passed down from history men to their eager listeners, and as these tales are told and retold, the truth of what really happened is left up to the audience to piece together. This oral history about the two-decade making of Mad Max Fury Road is primarily comprised of over 130 new interviews I conducted with members of the cast and crew, as well as a number of the film's notable admirers. Most of these conversations took place in 2020 and 2021, though a handful of the interviews occurred around the time of the film's release in 2015. Whenever people were unavailable to speak, I pulled from other published interviews, audio recordings, and video footage to provide additional perspectives. Many of the interviews have been condensed and edited for style and clarity, and a full list of sources is at the end of the book. Part 1. Building a World Gone Mad. Introduction. For 55 million years, the Namib Desert has been where things go to die. Thought to be the oldest desert on the planet, it's a barren wasteland, almost completely devoid of human life. A place where the coastline is still studded with the remains of 1,000 shipwrecks. And in September 2012, it was where Mad Max Fury Road would crash and burn. Nearly 10,000 miles separate that South African desert from Los Angeles, but midway through Fury Road's very long 2012 shoot, plenty of stories about the troubled production had already made their way back to the Hollywood rumor mill. Was it true that the film was wildly behind schedule and over budget because its mercurial lead, Tom Hardy, often failed to show up to set? Had a massive blow-up between Hardy and his co-star Charlize Theron required an outside intervention just so the film wouldn't collapse? And what the hell was George Miller making anyway? Though the director had spent months filming Fury Road in Namibia, the footage he'd sent back to Warner Brothers left many executives freaked out. The dialogue sounded incomprehensible, the action scenes appeared astonishingly dangerous. And since Miller wasn't working from a traditional screenplay, instead, in an unprecedented move, he had plotted the film out solely through storyboards, studio executives worried that Fury Road would make no sense once it was cut together. If this expensive boondoggle turned out to be a box office bomb, forget just losing their jobs. They might never work in Hollywood again. Jeff Robinoff, the bald and beleaguered head of Warner Brothers Pictures, had been sending underlings to the desert to check on Fury Road ever since the movie's June start. But during the last week of September, Robinoff himself flew over to Namibia to take control. The production was based in a massive tent city in the middle of the desert, a troubled oasis where several hundred crew members now waited to learn their film's fate. The first person Robinoff encountered there in the sands was P.J. Votan, Fury Road's loyal producer and first assistant director. "We're going to finish this film with or without George," Robinoff told him. Under his breath, Votan muttered, "Good luck with that." Eventually, Robinoff made his way to Miller, who cuts a deceptively mild figure. At 5'7", with wavy white hair, twinkly eyes, and a pair of amber-colored T-shade glasses, he has the pleasant Australian lilt and chatty disposition of a favorite grandfather. Perhaps because of that, Miller has been underestimated his whole career, with rogue crew members and studio executives frequently trying to seize control from a man who simply will not budge. Robinoff was hardly the first money man to clash with Miller, but on that day in the desert, he threatened to be the very last. Though there were still 3 months of shooting left on Fury Road and many crucial scenes still to come, Robinoff told Miller he would shut the film down early and then laid down an impossible ultimatum. With such limited time left, Miller could either shoot Fury Road's third act chase or sacrifice it to film the still unshot beginning and ending of the movie. No matter what decision Miller made, the outcome would be disastrous. The director had been imagining his dream project for over a decade and a half, and the head of the studio was about to blow a massive hole through it. But this was just another catastrophe on a project that was beset with them. Fury Road was one of the most elaborate and difficult shoots in Hollywood history, and the making of the movie stretched over 2 decades and 3 studios. Still, over years of countless obstacles that would have prompted almost any other artist to give up, Miller persevered. He could not quit until he had told this story, and what he fought for is now considered by many to be a masterpiece and the finest action movie ever made. Over several interviews with Miller, I had to ask, how did he keep the faith for so many years when everything was stacked against the making of this film? "The real answer is you have no choice," he said bluntly. "I just had to keep going." Then, as if he were a character from his own movie, Miller added, "You can't surrender." Though the scope of Fury Road is massive, the film's post-apocalyptic plot is boiled down to its barest essence. Nearly the entire movie is told on the run as drifter Max Rokitansky, Hardy, joins forces with the determined driver Furiosa, Theron, to spirit 5 young sex slaves to safety. Along the way, they are aided by the zealous turncoat Nux, Nicholas Holt, and pursued across the desert by a staggering armada of vehicles commanded by the warlord Immortan Joe, Hugh Keysburn, who wants to reclaim his harem of wives and murder his rogue lieutenant Furiosa for freeing the young women in the first place. But while Fury Road initially appears to be a simple car chase stretched to feature length, there is plenty going on underneath the hood, and the subjects that Miller smuggled into all that spectacle were subversive and unexpectedly powerful. How often do you see an action movie that tackles up-to-the-minute issues like environmental collapse, female empowerment, and resource hoarding by the rich? The world here is so detailed and incredibly realized that it resonates well beyond the borders of the frame. A film like Fury Road isn't just one of a kind. In this era of increasingly bland superhero movies, it's the sort of film that could probably never be made again. Many thought Miller couldn't pull it off, and some of those doubters were even working on the movie. To be fair, by the time Fury Road hit theaters in 2015, Miller was 70 years old and had not directed a live-action film in 17 years. It had been even longer, 3 tumultuous decades, since the world had seen a new Mad Max movie. And original series star Mel Gibson became professionally toxic in the interim, requiring a thorough rethink of what Miller had in mind. And what exactly Miller had in that prodigious mind remained the point of some contention. The confusingly piecemeal way he filmed Fury Road could frustrate his actors, who felt adrift and often clashed with Miller and each other. During the better part of a year spent in the vast, remote desert of Namibia, surrounded by sandstorms, shrieking stuntmen, and insane vehicular mayhem, there was such an emphasis on making this fantasy world feel real that the conflict of the characters even seeped into the actual lives of the cast and crew. You either had faith in Miller's mad vision, or you struggled. Almost every movie is hard to make, but few movies have a making-of story as wild, long, or difficult as Fury Road, and absolutely none of them turned out as influential and awe-inspiring. There's no doubt now that the movie is an all-time classic, but an important question still remains. Did Fury Road become great despite being forged in fire, or because of it? Chapter 1. Eyewitness accounts of those who survived. In almost every possible way, Mad Max Fury Road is a movie that should not exist. It's the fourth film in a long-running franchise, yet it was hailed by critics as one of the most original movies ever made. It's a big studio action movie, yet it was nominated for Best Picture and won several Oscars. And while it was a major hit when it was released in 2015, earning $375 million worldwide, Fury Road has only become bigger in the years since. At the end of the 2010s, nearly every major publication, including the New York Times, USA Today, Rolling Stone, and the Los Angeles Times, named it one of the best films of the decade. With its iconic characters, exhilarating stunt sequences, and incredible ingenuity, it's only natural to wonder how this modern classic was made. Even A-list auteurs can't figure Fury Road out. Parasite director Bong Joon-ho has said that the sheer scale of the movie brings him to tears, while Steven Soderbergh put it more bluntly. "I don't understand how they're not still shooting that film," Soderbergh once said. "And I don't understand how hundreds of people aren't dead."
Gina Prince Bythewood, director, The Old Guard. You watch Fury Road and you're really pushed back in your seat. Even knowing all the tricks that directors use, you still can't figure out how he did it.
Tom Hardy, Max. It's technicolor, surreal, and over the top with all these car crashes that are actually happening. It's magic. I haven't ever seen anything like it.
Edgar Wright, director, Last Night in Soho. It's an engine of pure cinema.
Patty Jenkins, director, Wonder Woman. How often do you see something so mind-blowing? First of all, George's taste is unparalleled. He's got the edgiest, most unbelievable eye. And this visceral, gripping vitality that comes out of the action is stunning. Jen Yamato, journalist, Los Angeles Times. It makes me feel more alive just watching it. And that feeling has never gone away as I've watched it over and over and over again.
Patton Oswalt, actor. I don't have words for it. It should just be holy fucking shit.
Nia DaCosta, director, Candyman. The audacity of it all. That's the sort of thing that initially got me into directing. The fact that you could literally do anything. And what George did is to say, yes, I'm going to go to the desert in Namibia to make this completely tonally wackadoo movie. And somehow it fucking works. I never would have been able to pull this movie off. It sounds like hell.
George Miller, director. Every day was physically demanding. There were no soft days. It was very noisy, very dusty, and very arduous.
Robin Glazer, second assistant director, Action Unit. No one can say they've worked on a movie like Mad Max.
Charlize Theron, Furiosa. Hands down, this is the hardest thing I've ever done.
Jason Bolan, still photographer. I think it was our apocalypse now. I really do.
Dane Hallett, key prop maker. You're not really allowed to make those movies anymore. You're not allowed to commit to this fucking insanity and get away with it. The studios are too scared.
Sean Genders, senior prosthetic artist. We call it the most expensive independent film ever made.
Doug Mitchell, producer. It was destined one day to be what it is today. It's now in the library of films, but there were umpteen times where it was irrelevant. Nah, that's never going to happen.
Looking back now, it's impossible to put into words what being a part of it meant to me. It left me irrevocably changed.
Riley Keough, capable. It was one of the wildest, most intense experiences of my life, to this day. Every moment is so emotional to me.
Abby Lee, the DAG. It was like being in a very tumultuous relationship with the love of your life.
Like anything that matters in your life or has some worth to it, it comes with complicated feelings. I feel a mixture of extreme joy that we achieved what we did,
and I also get a little bit of a hole in my stomach. There's a level of the body remembers trauma related to the experience of shooting this film that's still there for me.
Nicholas Holt. Nux. It was chaos out there, to be honest.
Kelly Marshall. Writer. Sometimes I think, was it made to be that way? Was it made to be really, really, really hard? George is not a person that wants to see one suffer. He really is the sweetest, kindest, gentlest man. But it's just like, is he an evil genius?
Josh Hellman. Slit. If you ever sat me down and showed me Fury Road knowing nothing and told me to draw the director, it certainly wouldn't be a grey-haired man who's incredibly soft-spoken and kind. It's something special that these two things exist so indelibly in him at the same time. You have to kind of wonder, when you meet the man, where does it come from? And then he'll tell you.
Chapter 2. The Mad Mastermind. Even some of George Miller's closest collaborators still regard him as a bit of an enigma.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.